Greetings, Earthlings. I have for you here another inbox review. This one is of a brand new kit. This is from Dragon's new Black Label range, and it's the MBT-70, or Kampfpanzersiebzig, which I think means the same thing. Now, Black Label is Dragon's new sort of boutique range. They have sort of cyber hobby at one end, and this is kind of at the other end. I'm told that these are done for the kind of the World of Tanks sort of market of interesting vehicles rather than necessarily widely used ones. So, what makes this an interesting vehicle? Well, this is actually a prototype of a vehicle that never went into production. The MBT-70 was a project that was started up in 1964 between the United States and Germany. Now, both of them were aware that the Soviet Union was coming up with bigger and better tanks, and both of them, and especially I think Germany, were aware that the next war, when it happened, and I think it was very much a case of when rather than if at that time, would take place in Germany. So the Germans had the Leopard 1, and the Americans at the time had the M60 as their main battle tank, and good as though those tanks were, they weren't really up to the task of stopping sort of the new T-62s that were coming on stream. So both of those countries really had a common purpose and a common sort of enemy, and they wanted the next generation of main battle tank in order to combat that. So they kind of decided that they'd grouped together to share the development costs, because obviously the cost of developing a machine like this is enormous. So in 1964 they sort of signed a declaration to say, yep, we're going to start this project. The idea was that the tank should be ready for use and in service by 1970, hence the name. Right from the get-go they ran into problems. One of the first problems they had was the units to use. The Germans were convinced that the next war would be fought in metric, whereas the Americans felt that imperial units were the way to go. They were good enough for the Romans, they were good enough for everybody else. So there was some bickering with that. Eventually it was decided actually to let the Americans use imperial units and the Germans use metric units, except where things actually had to fit together, in which case they'd use metric. Well, I think it should have been apparent to any outside observer by that point that the project was doomed. But they pressed on and came up with a bunch more compromises. First of all, there's something very strange about this. There's no driver's hatch. It was decided that the driver should go in the turret. And this is something that American designers at the time were very, very keen on. They decided that they wanted to have better protection for the crew, both ordinary armour and radiological protection, because, of course, everybody assumed that there were going to be nukes flying left, right and centre. So if you put all the crew in the turret, you just need to really to protect the turret. Whereas if you have a driver in the front of the hull, you need to protect that as well. And of course you need to have communication between the two, and everything becomes more complicated. Well, it's still pretty complicated to put a driver in the turret. As you can imagine, if you're driving along and somebody turns the turret, suddenly you're facing the wrong direction. So the driver was put in this sort of counter-rotating capsule here, and he had his own cupola. The idea was that as the turret turned, his cupola would actually turn the opposite direction. So that seemed like a good idea at the time. It had all kinds of other advantages. One advantage, of course, was that if the driver was incapacitated, since there are no direct controls, they're all electric, they could be duplicated for the commander. So if the driver was incapacitated, the commander could take over and drive the tank out of danger. On a long road march, it meant that if the driver was tired, he could hand over control to the commander, who could steer the tank for long enough for the other crew member to climb into the driver's seat and take over driving. Now, there were only three crew members. There was a commander, a driver, and a gunner. There was an auto loader fitted so that no human loader was required. And that in itself was a major job. There was also a 20mm cannon, Rheinmetall cannon, fitted for sort of use against soft skin vehicles. The main armament was a 152mm Shillelagh launcher, which also doubled as a gun. The Germans were not at all keen on this, and I think they kind of felt that since they'd given in and allowed the Americans to put in the driver in the turret, they were entitled to make a fuss about this. And it was kind of decided, I think, that the American vehicles would have the Shillelagh launcher, and the German vehicles would have a conventional 120mm Rheinmetall gun. So basically, there are two types of these vehicles. There's the MBT-70 itself, which is the US version, and there's the, I'm going to call it the KPZ-70, which was the German version. And this, of course, is the German version. They differ in detail. Although the turrets are pretty much the same, there are differences to the suspension and to the engine deck and other sort of details of stowage and so forth. The suspension is actually an interesting thing in itself because it was kind of hydraulically powered so that the tank could be raised and lowered so that you could, for example, lower it to lower its silhouette. You could also raise just one side or just the front or just the back so you could hunker the tank down behind some cover to make a more sort of hull down position, or if you needed to increase the maximum elevation of the gun, you could actually drop the rear of the tank and allow the gun to point upwards more. And of course, you could actually move the tank from side to side to counteract rough ground. So, as you can imagine, that was a fairly complex system. I think in all, I don't know, 12 or 14 of these were built. 12 or 14 prototypes. I think there are 6 or 7 for each country. There are two still in existence, as I know of the German version, one in Münster and one in Koblenz. And I think there's at least one still in existence of the US version. Now, Dragon say that they've been to the Münster Museum to sort of photograph and to measure the vehicle there, so it ought to be fairly accurate, hopefully. So anyway, that's the vehicle itself. I should point out that in about 1969, I think that the plug was pulled on the project. It was realised that it was going to cost over $500 million to get the project really off the ground, and that each of the vehicles would cost over $1 million just to build, and Congress realised that that was just going to be too much, so they decided to pull the plug. After that, the two countries went their separate ways. The Germans used what they'd learned from this to develop the Leopard 2, and the Americans played around with this for a bit, first of all making what they called the austere MBT-70, which was kind of a cut-down version of this with no Rheinmetall cannon, and eventually developed it into more and more conventional versions until what they ended up with was the M1 Abrams. So this is kind of the, if you like, the granddaddy to both the Leopard 2 and the M1 Abrams, so quite an important tank in its way. Okay, that's the historical waffle out of the way. What about the kit itself? Well, as I've said, this is part of Dragon's Black Label range. In fact, this is the second kit. They've announced three. The first one was the M103A1 heavy tank. This is the second one. The third one is going to be an M6 heavy tank. The first one has been pretty much panned by enthusiasts of modern US armour because it was horribly, horribly inaccurate. They got almost every dimension wrong. If you build it up, it looks kind of sort of like an M103, which is pretty good. I mean, it's nice to get some representation of an M103, but there were lots of complaints from sort of serious modellers that it really was just wrong all the way through. So I bought this hoping that it was going to be better, and it does seem to be. Let me just open up the box. You can see I've opened it already, and the reason I've opened it is so that I can actually measure it up. Now, there aren't too many drawings available of this vehicle, but I've managed to find some. These come from the Honeycutt book, the Abrams book, and they were originally 1:48 scale, so I've had to scale them up. But what I've found is that if I take, say, the drawing here, this is, by the way, the US version, although the turret and the general sort of dimensions should be the same. So if I take, say, the US version, I find the turret actually looks pretty much bang on. The mantlet does seem to be a little bit too narrow in the kit, but I'm assuming A, that the dimensions in these drawings are correct, and they're generally regarded as being definitive, the drawings in the Honeycutt books. And of course, I'm also assuming that I've got my mathematics right to scale the drawings up, which is by no means a given. But that looks about right to me. The hull looks about right for length and right for width. Bear in mind that this is a drawing of the US version and this is the German version. You should be able to see that the US version has a more plain engine deck, whereas the German version has two intake fans on the top. Other things like the wheels, they are also about right for size. So I think that in terms of scale, they seem to have got this one right. The scale seems to be right, the general layout of it seems to be right. So well done, Dragon. You've I think hopefully you'll shut up some of the naysayers who are very disappointed by the M103 kit. So, typical Dragon. It actually seems to me to be slightly different to normal Dragon plastic. This plastic actually appears to be, I might be imagining it, a little bit different. It seems to be slightly darker grey, for one thing. It seems to be slightly more brittle than a lot of Dragon kits I've had. It's almost like Italeri sort of plastic. But the quality is good. The detail is nice. There's good crisp detail on here. So I'm not too worried about that. The turret, I mean, this is a huge turret. It's got some, I don't know if you can make this out, very nice detail here around the, this is actually the gunner's hatch. This doesn't open on the kit, but all this part here is a nice cast texture. It's a nice detail here, this big panel underneath the turret with these hinges. This is actually where the auto loader was fitted, so it was actually mounted to this panel, and in order to maintain it, the turret was turned 90 degrees so that this hung over the edge, and then this was let down so that the auto loader could be accessed. So yeah, big old turret. Some sprues here of wheels and the I suppose it was complicated to design and maintain, but not very complicated to render in plastic. These are the sort of suspension units, and these all have trailing arms for the wheels attached to them. These all have a key molded on them. These have a keyway moulded in them, so that you can build it in the kind of the default, if you like, position. But simply by removing the key from these, you can alter the position of the suspension, much like the real thing. So that's very nice indeed. So that's very straightforward. Some suspension units, sort of swing arms, the sprockets, the idlers, and the road wheels. So the sprue where the turret was, and the turret basket here, and the trunnions for the gun. This is the sprue for parts of the turret. This is the gun. The it's a gun launcher XM8. Sorry, I can't remember what it is, but it's the 152mm launcher for the Shillelagh missile. That could also be used as a gun. It's slide molded. You can see there's a nice hollow end. There's no rifling in it. I think the original one was actually rifled. It's a bizarre sort of thing where I think the gun was actually rifled, but it had a key in it, or a keyway in it, and the missiles actually had a key that would basically enable them to fire through the gun without being affected by the rifling, because I think if the missile was spinning, then it wouldn't track. That's the 120mm Rheinmetall, 20mm Rheinmetall cannon. Very nice flush eliminator molded onto it. Again, slide molded. This is the mount for that cannon. These are the doors and sort of miniature turret for that. Some very, very fine parts here for the gun crutch. That's the driver's cupola. The gun mantlet. Again, as I said, I think this seems to me to be just slightly too narrow. Let me just double check that. Yeah, it seems to me to be just, I would say, probably 3 or 4 millimeters, probably 4 millimeters too narrow, according to those drawings. So how accurate those drawings are, I couldn't say. Anyway. That's there's a mount there for the searchlight, and there's all the stuff here for the various sights and missile tracking assemblies. The stern plate for the gun, the tank, blowers for the back, exhaust grill. This all looks, I mean, it looks very much like the back of a leopard, and it's fairly clear where the leopard's ancestry is here. Then some hooks and stowage hooks. Those are the front fenders. It's a very nice one piece lower hull with these mounts here for the very complicated suspension. The tracks are in DS-100 plastic. There's actually two lengths per track run, so you have to. There's four bits in total. You have to glue them together. This stuff glues pretty well, so it should be fairly easy. I'm not sure what they're like for length. I'm hoping they're going to be the right length, but they certainly look the part. They do look like the real track. There's a clear sprue here that contains, I think, the headlamp lenses, the lens for the commander's sight. Well, actually, no, that's for the gunner's sight, I think. That's for the commander's sight, and that's for the tracking box for the Shillelagh missile. A little erratum slip about fitting the gunner's sight. And these are the decals. Not very many decals, just a bridging weight plate, a couple of German crosses, and two number plates with a sort of number jungle set of figures to make up whatever registration numbers you want. But that's not all. There is also in here a booklet showing photos of the real thing, and explaining how the Dragon designers went to Munster to photograph it and measure it. It's quite reassuring sometimes to see things like this with a all the measuring stuff attached to it. It kind of makes you think that maybe this is the right size after all. That's an interesting thing. If you can't be bothered to put the numbers on your number plates, you could you can take solace in the fact that neither could the Germans. So that's pretty much it. I can show you the instructions, but there's not a great deal to see. You see, there's not all that many parts to this. The sprue map is fairly sparse, and again, it's actually a very small and simple set of instructions. Building the suspension. Here, this is actually arranging the suspension so that the tank can be tilted forward. You can tilt it backwards from side to side. And this part they call A45 is actually part of one of the sprues, and it's a little sort of jig to enable you to keep all of the wheels flat and in line, which is a very nice touch. Yes, fairly conventional build. Make the lower hull, glue the upper hull to it, glue the bits to it, glue the turret together. Nothing here that I think will really phase anyone very much. So I think it's going to be a fairly straightforward kit. It looks to me actually like a reasonably accurate kit. I mean, I'll need to study the photos in order to determine whether it's very accurate. It certainly looks to be closer to reality than the M103 was, which is a relief. I'm really pleased actually to see a kit of this in 35th scale, because I think it's a very, very interesting vehicle. And I'm looking forward to getting stuck into this, because I think it's quite a big vehicle, certainly an unusual one. And I don't think it's going to be a difficult build either. I think it's going to have the usual Dragon fit of parts, but there just aren't very many of them, which I think is a happy combination. Anyway, there's my opinions of that. Going on for 25 minutes now, so apologies to those who have felt the need to keep awake this long. That's the second kit in the Black Label series. The third one, the M6 heavy tank, which is a World War II US heavy tank, should be out in the next few weeks. I'll probably be getting that as well, because that looks also very interesting. In the meantime, I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have any comments, please let me know. And until I speak to you again, happy modelling and goodbye.